The French Chef is made possible by a grant from Safeway Stores.
Here are carrots, leeks, celery, pork, beef, a sausage, and a chicken. We're doing dinner in a pot today on The French Chef. Welcome to The French Chef. I'm Julia Child. Today we're doing dinner in a pot. It's a sumptuous French boiled dinner called pâté normand. Pâté means it's the big pot full of wonderful food, and that's just what this is. We have all these vegetables, and then we have all of our meats. We have pork or veal, and beef, and chicken, and sausage, and they all cook together in glorious harmony, and that's very easy on the cook, and it's a wonderful meal. You can, of course, you don't have to use all of this variety. You can just use beef only. In that case, with beef and vegetables, it would be called pot au feu, or pot on the fire. Or if you just used a chicken, that would be poule au pot, or chicken in the pot. And the great thing about this is you can do it all ahead of time. It's easy on the cook, and the guests have a simply wonderful time. And you end up with not only all your meat and vegetables, a one-dish meal, but you have a perfectly glorious soup to boot. So we shall start in with it right now. And now we have our beef. And the beef, this is a piece of chuck that comes from the ribs up in the shoulder. And this is called an undercut. And this is an extremely nice piece of beef you can use either for boiling or for braising. And if it's all, if it has the bones and the fat in it, it costs about 69 cents a pound. And if it's all been trimmed and boned the way this piece has, it's about 89 cents a pound, which you can use much more inexpensive cuts, say from the leg or round or from other parts of the shoulder. And now whenever you're going to boil beef, which we're going to do, you want to tie it up so it'll keep its shape while it's cooking. And usually your butcher will do this, but it's rather nice to know how to do it yourself. I'm going to put a tie right around the outside like that. And then I'm going to tie up some other all around the circumference of it, and that will make it sort of look a little bit like a sausage. It's a good idea when you tie to make a double twist of your thread, of your string. And then you can twist it around and it won't loosen up when you tie it. And it just needs about three ties so it'll keep its shape well. If you didn't tie it up, because particularly in a shoulder piece, there are quite a different groups of muscles, as you can see, and they would all separate, and then it wouldn't look as nice when you were serving it. And then when you have your beef, it depends on what cut and usually what price you pay, how long it takes to cook. This is of an extremely good piece of beef from a fine carcass, and this won't take more than about 2.5 hours. If you have a tougher piece, it may take 3 to 4 hours. And so you estimate your timing. I've lost my spring. You estimate the timing of how long this whole thing is going to take by how long each piece of meat's going to take. So if this was taking 4 hours, then you'd probably count 6 hours in all of stewing, but that means it doesn't mean you have to look at it while you're doing. I mean, you don't have to look at it very much. You just put it in the pot and let it go. Now I'm tying a long piece of string here and putting that in the pot. Then I'm going to tie the spring onto the handle. And that is so that I can lift it out and see how it is. In case, say, the beef got done before anything, before other things were done, I could just lift it out and then put it aside and then put it back into the pot again when it was time to heat it up again. And now here we have a rolled shoulder of pork. And this one's all been tied and I have a string on it. And what for stewing cuts, it's nice to have meat that has a little bit of fat and a little bit of lean in it. But if you're doing pork particularly, be sure that you have all the extra fat cut out of it. This is the shoulder butt. It's part of the front arm. And this is a very nice piece for either stewing or braising. And if you don't want to use pork, you can use a veal shoulder that's tied and rolled this way. Well, that goes into the pot. That I'm going to tie on also. And then the pork here weighs about 4 pounds and the beef weighs about 6 pounds. And we have enough here to take care of about 12 or 14 people. You can take care of 50 people if you want. It just depends on the size of your pot. I have a sister-in-law who has an enormous boiler like this called the Happy Home Laundry, and she can take care of about 50 people. And then we have our chicken that's going in. And if you noticed, when you go to your market, there's numerous types of chicken. You have the youngest one, which is called a broiler, and that's very young, and the flesh is very tender, and you can't boil a broiler. You can only cook that by dry heat, like roasting or broiling. And then you have the next oldest, which is the frying chicken, which you can use either for frying, roasting, or fricasseeing. And then you have your roaster, which is, as it says, just for roasting. And then your older chicken is called a fowl or stewing chicken. And that is a little over a year old usually. And when you pick out a stewing chicken, which this is, you want to be sure that it's a good looking chicken with lovely smooth skin and nicely filled out in the breast and in the legs. If it's scrawny and the skin is sort of scaly, that means it's probably an old hen and you just can't cook that tender at all. The stewing chicken has to be cooked by stewing. That means slowly simmering in water, which this is going to do. Now, another way that you can tell the age of a chicken is the end of the breastbone here. You see, there's your breastbone that comes up there. And with a stewing chicken, the bone is completely hard here. You can't bend it. But in a roaster or a frying chicken, there's cartilage from about here to there, and you can bend the tip. So that's always a good idea to look. If you have a roasting chicken that looks awfully big, you would, and you found that this was a hard bone, you'd think it was probably better if you stewed it. Now we're going to stuff this chicken. You can put the chicken just as it is, just tie it up and put it in the pot. But I thought you would like to see a nice way to stuff chicken. And we're going to have a breadcrumb and giblet stuffing. And I have here, these are the giblets. You know, they always come in a little package in the chicken. And I have the gizzard, which has been peeled and sautéed, and then about a cup of diced onions that were sautéed in butter. And then I chopped up the heart and the liver and sautéed them all. And it makes a very nice savory mixture here. And for the breadcrumbs, you want to be sure to use stale bread. And the easiest way to do the crumbs, I think, is to get a grater like this. And be sure that your bread is a little bit sort of hard and stale like that. And just rub it through the coarse end of your grater. Just like that. And if you find that you have fresh bread and you want to make it stale, just spread it all out in a roasting pan in the oven and let it dry out in about a 200 oven for half an hour or so. And then you want breadcrumbs about of that size, not too fine. And then as to the amount of stuffing, it is presumably that sort of a fairly good thing to go by is that, say, this chicken is about 5.5 pounds ready to cook. And you use you use 3/4 cup of stuffing per pound of ready to cook weight. So that means we want about 4 cups of stuffing. So we put our breadcrumbs into a big bowl. And then we want to moisten them with a little bit of bouillon or stock, or you can even moisten them with a little bit of milk. You don't want it to get too damp, just a little bit. And then you also want some butter in with it. We have the butter already. I cooked these giblets in about 4 tablespoons of butter, and they go in. Then, if you have any chopped scallions or onions, you can always add those too. They're always good in a stuffing. And then about 1/2 teaspoon of thyme. And we want about 3 or 4 tablespoons or 1/4 cup of parsley. You can put celery in too if you want. And then we have salt and pepper. I'm going to put in about almost 1 teaspoon of salt. And then several good grinds of fresh pepper. And then we have an egg, and the egg binds the stuffing together a little bit. And then you just stir it all up. You can see that egg is holding it together a little bit. And then you want to be sure and taste it to see that you've got enough salt and pepper in. Oh, that's good. You can put sage in rather than thyme. And now you truss the neck end of the chicken first. And this is a French trussing needle here. It's just a big metal needle. And if you don't have one of those, you can just use a wooden knitting needle and drill a hole in it. And you put the wings akimbo like that so they'll stay in place. That's sometimes a little difficult in a hen. I'll just have to break it a little bit at that point. There. Then you lift the legs up. I'll use this wooden knitting needle and just poke it right through. And bring your string out. See, there's one end of the string there. And then you turn it over and go through your, I think actually I'm going to just truss it this way. And then if it has enough neck skin, you try to get through that. And then just come through on the other side. I hope that's going to hold it there. And then pull it through. And then you use your same system of the twist so that it will hold together. So you give a double twist to your string that way, and then twist it again around so that it won't come loose while you're tying it. And then your stuffing goes in. It's a good idea to put a little bit of salt in the cavity first. And if you have any extra fat like that, just pull it out. But save the fat because it's awfully good for cooking with. And then you just put in your stuffing. And you want to be sure when you're stuffing a chicken that you don't overstuff it because it always swells a little bit. You should leave about 1 inch of unfilled space. And then if you have any extra stuffing left, you can put it in a little mold or dish and bake it in a pan of water in the oven. Cover it up. There. And then you just tie up the other end. If they've made a big hole in this vent part of the chicken when they've cleaned it, you often have to You'll have to sew up the vent, but I think in this case it was. It's all right. Now, on this, you go right through the end of the breastbone and then through the top other part of the leg. Pack your stuffing down a little bit. This is a very undignified position for the chicken, but it's easier to do that than it does things don't dribble out. There. And see, tying it that way, you don't see that is perfectly well closed so that you don't have the worry about the stuffing coming out, and then that goes into the pot. But I should have added a piece of string onto that also so that that can be pulled out. I should have, when I did that last tie, have left a long piece of string. And that goes in, and then we tie the string again there. And then we put water into the pot. In this case, we're lucky that all of these things take about the same amount of time to cook. We have, see, a stewing chicken takes between 2.5 and 3 hours. If you can also put it in, you can cut it up and put it in, and then it only takes about 1.5 hours. It never looks quite as fancy. You want to have enough water in there to cover your chicken and then also cover the vegetables which are to come. I think I'm going to have just about enough. I'll just put in the rest of this water here. There. And then we have our vegetables which go in. And the vegetables, you can put in soup vegetables to cook along with the chicken, and then your vegetable garnish would go in about, they should cook just about 1 hour, or a little over 1 hour, because you want the taste of this cooking soup and the vegetables all to sort of give a community of taste. Now here are leeks, and leeks for some reason seem rather hard to get, but they're available everywhere, and if your market doesn't carry them, just ask them that they do. It's a wonderful vegetable for soup or just as a vegetable. And when you get it, it looks like that. It has a slight onion taste, but it's more perfuming. It has the root end on here, and that you cut off. Then you take a knife and you slit it that way, and you slit it the length the other way. And then you open up the leaves and wash them under cold running water, because there's always a lot of dirt in the leaves. So you'll be sure and wash them thoroughly. And then, after they're washed, this one hadn't been, you can either wrap them in cheesecloths or you can tie them together again for easy removal. And you tie it just the way you tie bunches of asparagus. One tie at one end and one tie at another. And then these are very easy to remove. And then there's a tie at the lower end there. I forgot to put any salt into my pot. This is kosher salt. It's sort of a rock salt. It's very nice because you can pick it up with your fingers. And that would need probably about 2 or 3 tablespoons, which you can put in enough at the beginning, and then you can add more later. And then you'd also want, for further seasoning, you'd want an herb packet. So we will use parsley and some garlic. I'll use about 3 cloves and bay leaf. I'll even use 4 cloves because that's a big pot. And then tie those up in cheesecloth. And that again is so that the herbs won't disperse through your soup as they're cooking. So in they go. And you'd also would put some thyme and other seasonings in if you like. Then we would have the rest of our vegetable garniture. There are carrots. Those are just peeled and quartered. And those are You can wrap in cheesecloth also, as you'll see later on how this works. When we take it all out again, it's so much easier to have it in cheesecloth. And there, those go in. And if you have onions or turnips, those would also go in. And the sausage here, this is a smoked Polish sausage, that would go in half an hour before the end. So we'll just pretend that it's half an hour before the end, and that goes in. And be sure when you're using your cheesecloth that it's washed cheesecloth, because it always has sort of a taste of sizing, or so that would, you pick that up in your soup. And now I'm going to clear the decks and show you what we do for when your great pâté is all done. And this, for the timing of the pâté, because it can sit and wait, you don't have to, it's a good idea to start it a bit ahead of time. And say if you had, for one like this, I'd probably start it about 4 or 5 hours before I was going to serve it, because it can wait. This great big pot of water takes a long time to cool off, and it's better to have it done than not have it done. And so here's what that we have already done. And let me see, yes. Now you'll see how nice it is to have all your vegetables tied in separate packages. We have here our leeks. And that's a lovely aromatic soup that we have here. And that you can serve either as a first course for your dinner, or you can save it and use it another day. So there are leeks in a little plate. And then we have there are onions. You just cut off the cheesecloth. Cheesecloth you can get anywhere, and usually in any market, and it just comes in a little package, and then you just wash it out, and it's ready to use. There are onions, and we have carrots. That's hot. You could tie all your vegetables together in one bag, but then if you wanted to make a pretty decoration, it would be a little hard to separate them out. And now let's see what we have in here. Ha! There's our beef. Now with these, you can tell when they're done by when a fork pierces them easily. And as soon as that happens, then you know that they're done and are ready. And if the beef is done ahead of time, you just would take it out and let it sit in a little bit of the stock, because it'll keep more juicy if it's sitting in liquid. You see, that's kept together quite nicely by the string. Now, let's see what else we have. Huh, there's our pork. You can see what fun this is, really, because most people don't realize that you can just cook all of these things together. You wouldn't cook lamb along with it, because that has too pronounced a flavor. You could cook ham, but then everything would taste like ham. It's a good idea to have some really sharp shears in the kitchen. I hope I've got all those strings off. Oh, there's a little bit more. There's still a little bit more. That goes off. Now, what have we got? Ha! Here's some more sausages. These ones, rather than the Polish sausage, I got... Polish sausage is already smoked, and these are fresh Italian sausages, and they're very nice. Get that off. They have a very good flavor. And then, let's see what else we've got in here. You could, if you wanted to serve this, I'm going to serve this on a platter, so You can see things better, but you can't get them all untied and then return them back to sort of a serving pot if you have one. People don't know what you're about. They're simply amazed to see all these things coming out. Now we have chicken in here. Now this one, I cooked the chicken already all cut up so that you could see it done both ways. And that's terribly simple. You just wrap it again in your cheesecloth bag. And then you don't have the problem of carving. There. Now, we arrange it. Now put the chicken at the two ends of the platter. I sprinkle a little herbs on the chicken before I put them in the bag, just so that they would have even more flavor. And then your meats go in the middle. This pork came apart just a little bit. And then we'll arrange some of vegetables around. I think those leeks look very pretty. You could also have celery stalks if you wanted to. We'll put leeks on either side. Then we have onions. Turnips are very nice. You wouldn't, unless you, I don't think, cabbage is a very good idea, because if you want to use your stock for anything else, it all tastes of cabbage. And then we have our carrots, which make a pretty decoration. But if you're a really artistic type, you can do all kinds of decorations. I'll put the sausages there in the middle and put on a little more parsley, and we're ready to serve. That really is, as I said at the beginning, it is sumptuous looking. And with it, you'd serve a rosé wine or a red wine and some French bread and some rice or some potatoes simmered in some of your soup stock. And it just makes a perfectly lovely meal. And I'll serve a portion so you can see how it works. You carve off a piece. Everybody should get a little piece of everything. We have here our pork, and a sausage, and beef. And then, chicken. Yes, I'll give somebody a piece of the breast. And some carrot. And the wonderful thing about all of this is that you can get it done ahead about 2 hours at least, and then just let it sit in its pot, and you can warm it up a little bit again. So there we are, and you have only one pot to wash, and it's a great deal of fun for your guests and everybody. So that's all for today. I'm the French chef. This is Julia Child. Bon appétit.
Julia Child is co-author of the book Mastering the Art of French Cooking. Furniture and accessories courtesy of Design Research Incorporated. The French Chef is made possible by a grant from Safeway Stores.